Morning. I want to read to you from the book of Romans today. Romans chapter 14, verse 18 and 19 says, "For he who serves Christ in these things is acceptable to God and approved by men. Therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which one may edify another." Man, thank you, Kathy. Let's pray. Father, we just come together today, yet another day of worshiping you together as a church body. Lord, may we set aside the cares of the week right now and listen to what you have to say. Father, we ask that you teach us to even better edify one another. May we do the things we do for your glory, but for one another's edification and building up. And even this morning, Lord, as we sing, as we study, as we pray, even in our announcements, may you always get the glory in everything we do. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who enables all of this by his grace, in whose name I pray. Amen. Well, you'll notice, seeing your directory, there's another sheet there for a directory that we'd like to put together. So if you haven't filled one out yet, fill that out, drop it in the offering box on the way out. We're trying to put another photo directory together because it's been several years. You don't have to be a member of Open Door Baptist Church to be in the directory, not at all. And we are working with Life Touch again. That's who we used last time. They do a good job. We'll have 3 days in September in which from the afternoon into the evening, we'll have time slots. And you'll be scheduled for one of those slots. Come in, you have your photo sitting, and then you will get one free 8x10 out of this for yourself, as well as a directory when they're printed. And then if you want to buy more, if it's time for a family photo update, you can buy more. We did last time, and we probably should again. Naomi looks better and I don't, so I guess we better get a new family photo done. We do need help, though. Life Touch does all the photography, but we need help with people to set up the rooms. We need help with people to register as folks are coming in. You register them, get the information to the photographers. So if you'd be willing to do that, the more we have helping, the less time you'll have to put in. And let me know. We'd appreciate that. Deacons, don't forget, we got a meeting tomorrow night, just a regular scheduled monthly meeting. If you're on the men's ministry committee, would you meet with me briefly after the morning service back in the conference room? And we do have a baptism service scheduled for Sunday morning, July 26th. We got four young men there who want to be baptized: Alexander Brown and Jonah Baxter, Lucas Brown, and Ewan Goldlecker. Okay, so we want to I want to encourage these young men as they're just following the Lord. And then also want to let you know, if you hadn't heard yet, the deacons have invited Zachary Eshelman to come to Open Door and candidate for the position of assistant pastor. He and his wife Ruth and their three children will be with us the end of August, beginning of September. It'll be over a Sunday through a Wednesday they'll be here, okay? And we'll have a schedule printed out for you in the near future. what to expect while they're here. So you can take every opportunity to try to get to know these folks and seek the Lord's will in finding an assistant pastor. All right, they're coming from Oregon, where he is currently, they don't call him an assistant pastor, they call him the director of youth at the Baptist Church where he serves in Eugene, Oregon. All right, okay, well, the other pastor, Dave, is going to lead us in songs this morning.
They can do wonders now, Pastor, with a picture. They can probably fix you up. So all the songs that have been chosen this morning are songs with a prayer. So think about that as we sing. We're going to sing, "Oh, to be like Thee." Oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer. This is my constant longing and prayer. Gladly I'll forfeit all of earth's treasures, Jesus, thy perfect likeness to wear. Oh, to be like Thee, oh, to be like Thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as Jesus, and I guess if we're going to be like him, we're going to have to know more about him. And so we're going to sing these four verses. We may read one or two of them. So let's start on the first verse to sing. Third verse, more about Jesus, let me learn, more of his holy will discern. Spirit of God, my teacher be, showing the things of Christ to me. And the third verse will sing, read, more about Jesus in his word, holding communion with my Lord, hearing his voice in every line, making each faithful saying mine. And we'll sing upon the fourth. More about Jesus on his throne, riches in glory all his own. More of his kingdom sure increase, more of his coming Prince of Peace. More about Jesus. It's become a favorite of many people is Be Thou My Vision. And again, it's a prayer. What things were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ, Philippians 3:7. King of heaven, my treasure thou art. Those words just terrific. High King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven, joy's bright heaven sun. Heart of mine, O heart, whatever
Lord is good and faithful.
One of the drawbacks of having two separate services in the morning is, well, they're identical except for the special music, which means not everybody gets the benefit of both except for me. Yeah. And I'm just telling you, God keeps giving us wonderful pieces for both services. Praise the Lord. This morning's music, the hymns we sang and the song that we just heard, centers around Jesus, and that's what our life has to center around if we're going to do the things that he would call us to do. As soon as Jesus is not the center, the way we relate to each other will just fall apart. Now, Dr. Delaney was my one of my Bible professors, one of my seminary professors, and he just went home to be with the Lord last month, I think. And he actually spoke here. He was our VBS adult speaker about 18 years ago. And he was a short man. He wasn't very tall in stature at all. He looked like he was between 80 and 200 most of his life. He probably looked that old when he was in his 30s. And Naomi was his secretary. He was very intimidating to me when I was a new student. He really intimidated me. But Naomi was his secretary. And she had put too many grounds in the coffee maker one morning. And so when he came in the office, she said, "I'm sorry, Dr. Delaney, I think I made the coffee too strong." Dr. Delaney replied, "There's no such thing as strong coffee, just weak men." And you know, spiritually speaking, that's really all there is. Weak men, mankind, that is. Okay, we are by nature spiritually weak. And when we come together, we're not necessarily any stronger. How can I say that? Because there is such thing as a weak church. There are weak churches. The proper use of spiritual gifts in a local church will make all the difference. When gifts are used, and especially when they are used for the right reasons and out of the right motives, you will have a strong church the way God designed a local family of believers to be. Now, chapter 14 in 1 Corinthians is going to conclude this topic of spiritual gifts. We've been talking about this for a while now because spiritual gifts came up a couple of chapters ago. And chapter 14 brings it to a close. But we're going to take three sermons to cover chapter 14. It's a rather lengthy chapter. It's 40 verses. Because the Corinthians were doing something with their spiritual gifts. They were doing a couple things that brought disunity to their church. And one of the things, of course, was they were using their gifts for themselves. And the whole reason you have a gift from God is to give it or use it for the benefit of somebody else. That was one thing they were doing. Something else they were doing, they were misplacing the priority of the gifts. There was a priority to these gifts. And the Corinthian believers placed greater emphasis on the gift of tongues than they did on the gift of prophecy. And what are those? Well, the gift of tongues was the ability to speak a language one did not know how to speak, or the ability to understand or interpret a language that one normally could not interpret or understand. The gift of prophecy was the gift of giving forth God-given truth before it was put in print in the Bible. We don't have either of these gifts today. Some people believe we do. The gift of prophecy was completed when the Apostle John wrote the book of Revelation. That did what we call closing the canon of Scripture, meaning God's written word was done. So there's no more direct revelation given to a person in order to prophesy. So prophecy wasn't just foretelling the future, it was forthtelling. So in that sense, a pastor is not a prophet. He foretells what's already given in the written word. A pastor does not receive direct revelation. We don't believe tongues are for today. We believe that completed as well. But those were both in existence back in the day of the Apostle Paul and the Corinthian church. And they believed that the gift of tongues was more important or of higher priority than prophecy. So Paul wrote this section of the letter to say, you have that backwards. And this entire chapter revolves around the gifts of tongues and prophecy. And you say, now how are we going to spend 3 weeks on this? Well, we don't even practice the gift of tongues and prophecy anymore. And it's true, we don't have these today, but we do have plenty of other gifts. And just as the Corinthians misused those gifts, so too can we misuse the ones that we have. So while Paul taught specifics about the gift of tongues and the gift of prophecy, and we'll look at those specifics, he also taught principles that apply to all spiritual gifts, no matter what they are. And it is those principles that we're going to pull out of this chapter and apply to ourselves and how we serve here in our own church family. So just what is the main principle? This chapter is broken down into three principles. What's the main principle today as seen in just verses 1 through 5? Simple. It is all about how the use of spiritual gifts is meant to be edifying. That's the whole theme of this section. The use of spiritual gifts is meant to edify. Edification is one of Paul's favorite words. He used it a lot. He uses a lot in this section. It comes up several times. It comes up in verse 3. He who prophesies speaks edification. Verse 4, he who speaks in a tongue edifies. Verse 5, I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets that the church may receive edification. Verse 12, even so, you, since you are zealous for spiritual gifts, let it be for the edification of the church. Verse 17, for you indeed give thanks well, but the other is not edified. And then finally, verse 26, how is it then, brethren, whenever you come together, each of you has a psalm, has a teaching, has a tongue, has a revelation, has an interpretation. Let all things be done for edification. That word is an architectural term. Do you know that? That's how they used it back in Paul's day. Is the idea of building a levee or a retaining wall or a barrier or a bridge, making it stronger. That's what edification means. I don't know if you remember, several years ago, Pastor Paul hit the clothesline at Parsonage One. He hit one of the poles with the lawnmower and just ripped that baby right out. Just took the whole thing, the whole concrete stump and everything out. So he said, sorry. I said, thanks a lot. And I fixed it. So I dug the hole a little wider, but evidently I didn't go deep enough because I poured that fresh concrete and reset the pole. And it was only, it was that same summer. It was just a matter of weeks later. The youth group was playing a game out here in the dark, and Pastor Paul went tearing through that area and literally clotheslined, and ripped that baby out again, whole stump and all, with his neck. I couldn't believe that. So this time, I dug that hole much deeper, and I built a form up 8 inches above the ground level. So if you go look at that pole now, okay, there's a concrete block holding that thing all the way in the ground. I said, let's see him rip that thing out now, okay? What did I do? I edified the clothesline. That's what I did. That's all it means. It means to build it up stronger. And we always need edification. Why? Because just when you think you're strong enough, God will send something to prove you're not. And I need to be built up more. There's no end to the resources of God's word, which means there's always something more by which to grow. So here's what Paul did. The first thing he did for the Corinthians' benefit to help set them straight, because that's what this whole letter is doing, is number one, Paul prioritized the gifts. He says, let's make sure you understand what these are. Look at verse 1 of chapter 14. It says, first of all, he says, pursue love. If you remember from chapter 13, love is not one of those spiritual gifts, okay? Love is a practice that every single one of us can do. It is the act of seeking the highest interest of somebody else by what you do with the expectation of zero in return. That's what love is. He says, pursue that. Every one of you can pursue that. But he says, desire spiritual gifts. If God doesn't give you a gift, you can pursue it, but you're not going to get it. But you can desire and you can grow. You know, I don't have the gift of evangelism. That's one of the spiritual gifts. It's not mine, and yet I still better evangelize, shouldn't I? And I can get better, even though it's not natural for me. So he says, desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. That you may prophesy. See, he never taught that all gifts were equal. He never taught that. There actually is a priority to these things. Back to the illustration of the human body from chapter 12, right? It says there are some parts of the body that you just can't live without. You can't live without your heart. But you can live without an eye. You can live without both, okay? You can live without your thumbs. But just because there is a priority there doesn't mean that the eyes or the thumbs are not important. They have a role, and they make a difference. Do you know even the organs within your body know their place? Did you know that? You'll find out if you go on a crash diet. You ever try that? Get up in the morning, have a little bit of yogurt. I'll eat an apple for lunch, and then at night, a few pieces of lettuce and a carrot. Do that for a few days. How do you feel? What's going on in your body is the organs know. They know their place and who has the hierarchy. And when you starve your body of nutrients and the vitamins and the minerals that it needs, the lower priority organs will reject what little nutrients you give them and send those nutrients to the higher priority organs like the heart. And that's why you feel lousy, okay? Because some of your organs are basically just shutting down. And the exact same thing will happen to a church body when spiritual gifts are treated the same way. When Christians are starved of the act of serving one another and the act of being blessed by the service of one another. You starve people of that and you watch what the church does. Okay, so God never denies that there is a priority in gifts. There most certainly are. There are certain gifts that if the church doesn't have, it can still go on, just not as effectively. There are other gifts that if they're not exercised, you do not have a biblical church, such as the gift of preaching the Word of God, the gift of preaching. If that is left out of a local body, okay, we can still come together, we can meet, but it won't be a biblical church. And let me tell you, there are churches that do exactly that all over the country that meet every week without the Word of God, without Scripture. So spiritual gifts have their place in a certain order. And what Paul is saying is the preaching, or that's the prophesying of God's truth, takes priority above the gift of tongues. That's just the opposite of how the Corinthians thought. And so they were neglecting the preaching of God's truth. They were downplaying prophecy. This individual had a prophecy, a truth, something that God gave him that the people needed, and that they downplayed and said, let's hear from so-and-so speaking a language that he doesn't know. And they put that as a priority. Right? So he prioritized them right out of the bat, off the bat with this. And then in verses 2 through 4, I want you to see, or 2 through 5, that Paul compared the two gifts. And not downplaying either of them and saying one's unimportant, he's just saying one is of higher importance. That's all. Look at verse 2. He says, for he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men but to God, for no one understands him. However, in the Spirit, he speaks mysteries. Remember, mystery in the New Testament just means a biblical truth that is not clear in the Old Testament, but made clear in the age of the church. Now, some of your translations probably says in verse 2 that he who speaks in an unknown tongue. Does some of yours say that? You notice that the word unknown is italicized? Okay, the reason for that is the translator is telling you that that word is not in the original language that this was written in. That word was inserted by the translators for clarity. Okay? Meaning it is a human addition, not an inspired one. Sometimes translators get it right, sometimes they don't. I find it unfortunate that they would put the word unknown before the word tongues. That indicates that the language that these gifted believers spoke was unknown to all mankind, like an angelic type language. And that's what a lot of Christians believe today. We call them charismatic churches, okay? In which they believe that Christians have the gift of speaking a heavenly angelic language unknown to mankind. But if this is the same type of gift of tongue seen in Acts chapter 2, well, then what we have are actually not unknown languages, but known languages. Because Acts 2 makes it very clear that the languages those apostles were speaking were known languages. It's just not languages the apostles knew, okay? But some of the other people in the audience knew them. They say, hey, he doesn't speak my homeland tongue, and yet he is, you see? And that is more than likely what was happening in Corinthians as well, or in the Corinthian church. They were speaking known languages, except they were often doing it when there was no interpreter. That was the problem. See? And that's why he says in verse 2, he who speaks in a tongue, that means without an interpreter, does not speak to men because they don't understand him. He speaks to God because only God understands. My Spanish is horrible. I'm not fluent. It's a shame. You know, I'm half Mexican, for crying out loud. My dad speaks very fluent Spanish. So do my grandparents. But they would all use the language as a code language when they wouldn't talk about his grandkids in front of us without us knowing what they were saying. So no one really made a real hard effort to teach us. I didn't hear it in the home. So my Spanish is broken. Caleb Burkow just spent 11 months in Peru. He got pretty fluent at speaking Spanish. So if all of a sudden I gave the morning announcements in perfect Spanish this morning, okay, well, good would it do? Caleb Burkow's not here. Do any of you speak Spanish fluently? No? Okay. It would be worthless. Now, if Caleb was here and says, here's what Pastor announced today, right? You see, now that would mean something. Well, the Corinthians had, some of them had the gift of tongues, but they were speaking languages that nobody understood. And it probably, because they were so self-oriented and self-centered, it probably became a means of showing off and not a means of building up. And that's why the Apostle Paul said, that language has its place, but it takes place beneath the language of prophecy. Because if someone stands up in a tongue and no one understands that tongue, it does no good. But if someone stands up and gives forth God's truth that can affect the way you live tomorrow, well, now everybody benefits from that, right? Or at least everybody could. So, he says in verse 3, but he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. So, what he's saying is prophecies benefit the entire church family. Everybody can benefit in three ways. First of all, he says, by way of edification, by way of building up. Okay? The giving forth of God's truth produces a stronger people and thus a stronger church, is what it does. But you cannot do so without the Word of God. You cannot build up people in God's truth without God's truth. And as I said, it's sad to say, churches meet all over the nation without God's word. People have been trying to strengthen themselves outside of God's word since Adam and Eve, since Satan. Satan had the word of God, and Satan said, eh, and did it his way. And then Adam and Eve had the word of God, it was clear, and they went, eh, and they tried it their way. Cain and Abel received the word of God. Abel listened, Cain heard it and said, eh, and he tried it his way. King Saul knew exactly what God's instructions were and what he was supposed to do with all of the loot and the takings of the enemy. And King Saul went, eh, and he tried it his way. And Christians today, even believers today, who will go to church regularly, have the word of God, and in areas of life will go, eh, and try it that way. And no one's built up when we do things outside of God's word. So this is why prophecy was more important than tongues. Today, we don't have prophets, but we have the completed word of God. Folks, that's even better. That's why this is a great era to live in world history. I don't care how bad it gets out there. We have it perfect in here because of Jesus Christ, and that can never be taken away. And yeah, this could be an ugly life, and it could get tough here, but it's the worst you're ever going to have it, Christian. It just, you have more to look forward to. And you live in an era where you have all the resources you need in the Word of God. The Apostle Paul could not say that. The Apostle Paul, in this fleshly body, never read the book of Revelation. He's read it now, but he didn't read it while he was here. You can. Okay? So edification is a wonderful benefit of prophecy. Prophecy benefits the church in another way, he says, and that is by way of exhortation. Exhortation. What is it to exhort someone? All it means is to call somebody over because you got something really important to tell them. That's what it means. It says, hey, come here, gather around. You're going to want to hear this. You're going to be encouraged by this. That's what it is to exhort. It's when the parents are frantically looking for the two-year-old because he cannot be found anywhere. And they're running outside, and they're in the backyard, and the front yard, and they're looking at every place in the house, and the panic is going up. And then mom calls to her husband and says, hey, come over here. Come here. And walking upon her, they look, and he sees his little boy sleeping behind the couch. She exhorted her husband. Said, come here, I got this is where it's at. And you're going to be encouraged by this. Well, prophecy did that. And preaching can do that. It exhorts. Okay. And he also says there in verse 3 that he teaches that prophecy edifies by way of comfort. Okay, it benefits by way of comfort. And when we say comfort, you know, we have that in our covenant. It says, you know, we strive for the advancement of the church in knowledge and holiness and comfort, it says in our covenant. By that, we don't mean we're going to replace the pews with lazy boy recliners. Right? And we do try to make things comfortable in that sense. That's why we have air conditioners in the summer and a furnace in the winter. And we try. But that's not what this is talking about. This is talking about spiritual comfort. The Word of God brings comfort to your life regardless of what's going on. Well, we need that. We need that when we think times are really, really good. And yeah, we need that when times are really, really tough. I didn't say bad. Remember, for the born-again believer, hard times are not bad, just hard. But when they're hard, comfort. Comfort comes from Scripture. And it's sad to see so many believers turning to everything else but the Word of God for comfort. And we're simply losing that more and more in this generation. Why is it? You know, you visit somebody, you know, you visit the older folks. So what kind of, what would you like me to read from the Word of God? So many of the older folks find joy in the Psalms. Would you read a psalm to me? I don't care which one. They all talk about how great God is. And there is comfort in that. And we're losing that. Now, everyone's got to deal with their stress with all kinds of methods and unbiblical means. Got to do this, got to do that. I'm not talking about every now and then you need a break. I do too. Absolutely. But spiritual comfort and depth can only be found in the deep pool of God's Word. There is no denial of the value of tongues in this. Like I say, he's not downplaying it. Notice verse 4 and 5. He says, he who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. And again, the idea is when there's nobody to interpret, as he'll say in a moment. He says he edifies or builds up himself because it is edifying to yourself to exercise your gift. Do you see that? If God gives you a gift and you don't use it, not only do the people around you lose the benefit, but so do you. But when you use your gift, well, you grow stronger as well as the people you serve. So, he who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies, who gives forth the truth, edifies the church, the body. He says, I wish you all spoke with tongues. They didn't. Because no Christian has all the spiritual gifts. And again, there are true born-again believers, your brothers and sisters in Christ, who believe that tongues are for the day. And they're in charismatic and Pentecostal churches. Okay? But there's a lot of key differences in what they believe and what Scripture says. And one thing they believe is, if you're a born-again believer, you should be speaking in tongues. They believe in the gifts for everybody. But it wasn't for the Corinthian church. It says, I wish you all spoke with tongues. They didn't. It says, but even more, that you prophesied. And they all didn't do that either. It says, for he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues. Doesn't mean the individual is greater. He's talking about the priority of the gifts. He says, he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets that the church may receive edification. You see, that was the value of tongues. When somebody spoke in a language foreign to himself and somebody else understood it. Edification. People grew. So see, this wasn't devaluing the gift of tongues, and whatever your gift is. You may feel that your gift is more like in the lines of a thumb and not a heart of the church. Hey, your gift is not to be devalued. The result of using your gift, edification. What there is just a greater emphasis on prophecy in this text. That's all. Okay. See, the Corinthians didn't sit in a church building with their Bibles open in their laps. Okay. They didn't do that. Couldn't do that. They didn't have church buildings then, for one. They met in homes. And they didn't have the written word of God yet. All they had was, well, they had the Old Testament, but even that, they didn't have in complete form. They had bits and pieces of that. The Bible in its entirety to be printed and bound was yet to come. And so prophecy was extremely important for them in order to understand God's truth for them to live their lives. Without prophecy, they wouldn't know God's will. And we have the Word of God. We have it complete. But building up in the Word of God must come from the Word of God. The Corinthian believers were using their gifts to build themselves up and not the people around them. You know, we would normally say that in order to help someone grow, you have to be strong yourself first. Like in an airplane, when you get on a plane and they tell you if the cabin pressure drops and these oxygen masks are going to fall from the ceiling, put yours on first, they say, and then help the child or the person next to you. And you, that's selfish. Well, no, because if you don't get your oxygen mask on, you're going to pass out. Then what good are you to anybody? So get yours on first, so that you're strong enough to be a help to those around you. So we say, isn't it the same way with our gifts? Well, individually, I suppose that's true. But the context here, 1 Corinthians 14, isn't talking about the individual. It's talking about the church as a whole being edified. You notice how that keeps coming up? The church is edified. So if you want your church to grow strong, okay, edify the person next to you. Build people up around you, and your church as a whole will get strong. Build yourself up above others. That's contagious too, and the church as a whole will get weak. So that's why you have your gift in the first place, to use it for someone else's benefit. The greatest use of any gift always emphasizes the word of God and his truth. Any gift you have, the greatest use of it is when God's word and its truths are taught and lived. And when you do that, you create just a wonderful environment to grow. This is why we preach God's truth. This is why we teach God's truth. And this is why we sing God's truth. So that people grow. So that the people live. And when you do this, it creates a wonderful cycle. Not a vicious cycle, a wonderful one. You build up the people around you in the truth of God. And it creates an environment in church in which individuals get built up in the church so that they too build up those around them, which creates an environment where individuals come in and get built up, and around it goes. All right? And this is how churches get strong. By building up the person next to you, you build up the church. By building up the church, you create a local body of believers where people are built up and build people next to them. But this kind of bodybuilding has got to come from Scripture. Has to come from the Word. And I don't mean just knowing the Word of God, but living it. There are a lot of people that know the Word. A lot of people that know the Scriptures. But if that's all they have, so what? We learned that in chapter 8. That kind of knowledge just puffs up. This makes somebody proud. I know stuff that she doesn't know, that he doesn't know. I know this stuff. They don't know that, and I do. What good does that do? No, to live the Word of God is to show you know the Word of God. If all you do is know it and don't live it, well, what good does it do? And so there you have it. Here, right here, is the material that we need. This is all we need. So let's edify. Father, as we consider our place and our role here at Open Door Baptist Church, pray that you will give every one of us a spirit of humility, even if you have to put a hard situation in our path to do it. May we be humble so that we put ourselves in the right priority here and use our gifts to glorify you, but to edify and build up those around us. May this church, in spite of the pandemic, in spite of the crisis, in spite of whatever else comes our way, because we know Satan's not done, and sin is not by any means over in this world, may we still grow stronger as a church and as individuals who build each other up. May we do so to your glory, to your credit. May it be obvious we do not walk and live in the flesh, but we walk by faith, by the Spirit of God. Amen. Pastor Dave's going to come and lead us. He does such a good job in a song we haven't sung in a long time, but it's a good one. O Church, Arise.
All right, let's think about it. What are we going to do this week as a church? Let's arise, okay? Oh, the church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now's the weak, and say that they are strong. That God has lies, and arm be bold. third verse. I love this verse. Read it with me. Come see the cross where love and mercy meet, as the Son of God is stricken. Then see his foes lie crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen. And as the stone is rolled away and Christ emerges from the grave, this victory march continues till the day when with Christ we stand in glory. Boy, isn't that good? Let's all stand and sing on the last verse. So, Spirit God, put strength in every stride. Give grace for every hurdle, that we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. As saints of old still light the way, retelling triumphs of his grace. We hear the call and hunger for the day when we're
Thank you, Pastor David. Don't forget tonight, 6 o'clock, Sunday school for all ages. And if you're on the men's ministry committee, if you could meet me in the back right now, it'd be greatly appreciated. Hope to see you this evening.